Gathering together remains an important part of the cultural makeup of Australia. However, the places in which community is found is evolving. When you think about where the heart of the community is for you, I wonder if you're thinking that it's the local park or the sports ground, perhaps it's a cafe or even the local shopping centre. Well, in the wake of the pandemic, the way communities come together has evolved, reshaping the significance of various gathering places. So joining me today to discuss our latest research on this exact topic is the amazing social researcher and director of solutions at McCrindle, Geoff Brailey. Geoff, welcome back to the podcast.
Yeah, thanks, Ashley. It's great to be with you and g'day to everyone listening in.
I think you're a really great person to have on the podcast for this topic, which is why I asked you to come on today, because I know that you're passionate about community. You're one of those people, Geoff, that really, I think, lifts the energy and the vibe of a space. And I think, well, do you think it's a fair interpretation that I have of your personality that you're someone who values community?
I'm a hype girl, I think, Ash, is what you're saying there. But yeah, I love seeing a group of people come together. One of my Gallup strengths is woo, so I do love meeting new people, and I'm that person that will walk up to people if we're at the park and I've got young kids. So it's a nice space to make connections, and I'm happy to walk across the room and say g'day to someone and learn about their life and their family. And yeah, certainly love hosting parties with my wife. She's great in hospitality as well. So whether it's a picnic at the park with some friends or having people around, we love building community and just helping people connect. I think life's better together. So certainly been a core part of my story that, yeah, my family always were inviting people around or meeting up at parks and going on holidays with other families. So I think community is a key part and, yeah, key part of life. So stoked to be able to talk about it and have fresh data. How good's life when you get fresh data on a topic you love? This is as good as it gets.
Oh, absolutely, definitely. And I think, I mean, we're going to talk a little bit about the impact of the pandemic on this today as well. But I think for me, even like community was really highlighted in the pandemic when we weren't able to meet with other people and just the importance of it and something that we might take for granted then stripped away and you go, oh, wow, I really miss connecting with other people, whether it's people we don't know or friends and family that we're used to. So it was really interesting to, yeah, run this study over the last few weeks and to have this fresh data. And, I mean, we've definitely, our whole world has seen this significant transformation from the impacts and the aftermath of the COVID pandemic. So, Geoff, I'd be keen for you to, I guess, shed some light on how the concept of community gathering places has evolved. Is it kind of just my gut or is there some insights that you can bring as to, you know, how this is shaped or changed post-pandemic?
Yeah, I think you're exactly right. I think there was three phases as we were in that lockdown, and introverts were probably loving lockdown life where it was a community of one and they could just get on with life and work and hobbies at home and enjoy their own company. I think we also noticed, though, that isolation was a key issue affecting everyone. And so as we came out of lockdowns, there was that first stage where people were probably a little bit cautious and just gathering with the select kind of loved ones and friends. I think it then went into the second phase, which was where we went a bit more lavish and we were ordering big when we went out for a meal together with people. And then we were at, and we'd sort of gone from meeting at the park as a nice safe venue in stage one to the big expensive restaurant stage two. And then stage three now is that resettling into a new normal. Hate to say it, but I think we're into a bit of a settled life after lockdown with almost 2 years since the last lockdown here in Australia. So I think our social patterns have changed and where we enjoy community has changed and evolved because of the impact of lockdowns. I think parks have had a bit of a renewed focus. Those green and blue spaces, whether it's the beaches, the waterways, or those natural parks that Australia is known for, that natural beauty, that natural wonder, whether it's the Blue Mountains or the ranges all across Australia, we've certainly got just brilliant amenity that's natural, that's free. And certainly something that I think a lot of Australians flock to when they've got time off work and want to hang out and relax with their friends and loved ones. So community is certainly found in a few different places, as our latest research has shown.
Yeah, that's right. It's really interesting. We were, you know, when we were putting this survey together, it was based on one we had run a few years ago about, I'm pretty sure it was for Woolworths actually, about the shopping centre being the heart of the community. Of course, they wanted that to be the outcome because they're a shopping centre and they want people to go there. So we thought, oh, it's time to rerun that study and these questions and to ask people where they feel they most are likely to find community or where they gather with other people. And it was really interesting to see that that has really shifted now, as you mentioned there, to parks and community parks and sports grounds have taken centre stage as kind of the vital gathering place, with a substantial percentage of Australians valuing them as the primary hub for interaction. And again, just for me, when they first saw this result come out, I immediately thought back to those stages of lockdown where that was kind of the only place you could meet people. And those days where you'd be working from home all day and you're like, I need to get out, I need some sunshine. The only place you could go was maybe a park within 5 kilometres of your residence. And you'd go there and it was absolutely packed. Like, everyone's out there with the dogs they might have bought in COVID, and they're walking around, and it was actually very wholesome. Like, I was like, oh, this is nice. These community parks are full. And so I wonder if, yeah, maybe that's a lingering impact. But I'm also keen, Geoff, to hear your thoughts on what factors have contributed to this trend, and how do you see these spaces, I guess, continuing to evolve now that we're out of the pandemic and in the years to come?
Yeah, I think we certainly saw parks as a key place to connect that was safe and accessible, and you didn't have to do a QR code scan. You remember having to do that in lockdowns? Oh,
yeah.
Goodness me. Certainly, I think the park, the local park within walking distance or a quick drive, is just such a powerful place to unwind, to relax. We know that we've kind of lived through some pretty challenging times, and there's been financial pressures, there's been emotional tolls on people, on their well-being. And so we know that the sort of evidence shows that when you spend time out in nature, that's good for our mental health. And so I think we've recognized that, we've started to build that into our lifestyle, into our rhythms, into our social patterns. And I think even in the fact that in the factors around our economic conditions at the moment, with the rising cost of living, if you're a mortgage holder and you've got that interest rate rising, if you've come off your fixed loan, you're probably thinking, yep, I think we'll switch from going out for dinner with friends and we'll just go and have a coffee at the park and let the kids play, and we'll find that a little bit more cost-effective approach to finding social connection. That's still so crucial. I think we just see in the data even that the generations find community in different places. And so while parks is the top place overall for people to find community, for the younger Gen Zs, it is the pubs and clubs, the restaurants, that people are finding community. So maybe that younger, a little bit more disposable income, looking for community, and certainly probably getting out of mum and dad's house to find time with their friends as well. If they're a kipper, the kids in parents' pockets eroding retirement savings, those kippers are probably getting out and enjoying some quality time at last with their friends without mum and dad watching over their shoulder. So I think we look for community in so many different areas. And probably just the other comment I'll make is that I think we've shifted from being, looking for community in our institutions. Now we look for bit more organic community, and it might be those casual connections, the friends, the neighbours, the work colleagues. We find community a little bit more organically, as opposed to what might have been the big structural places. And certainly they're key and still an active part of community, places like scouts or religious communities that people might participate in. But we certainly have a bit more of an organic approach. And that means we're, I think, now much more multicultural in our communities, multigenerational. We're not just in a monocultural or monogenerational interaction. And we're certainly also much more flexible where we build community, because people are moving more. Whether you're a renter or changing jobs, you might be moving those social circles. And so I think we're learning how to build friends a little bit better in these days, as we certainly are a bit more mobile in work and life and where we live as well. So we're looking for community and using those key places like parks, using those cafes and restaurants as places to build those connections with new or existing friends.
Yeah, it was really interesting, like you mentioned there, and you touched on quite a lot of trends in that answer, Geoff. So thank you. But I think, like you said, for every generation except for Gen Z, the top place for interaction and community hubs and gathering was the local park or sports ground. But Gen Z were the only one who said the local pub or club. And even, you know, we've come out of this World Cup season, and really the pubs and clubs and sports grounds have been kind of key places for people to gather and to connect and to cheer on the Matildas that we've seen over the last few weeks. So it's been really interesting to see those evolve. But also, like you said, you know, there's lingering impacts from the pandemic, but then there's economic reasons as well that might drive people to particular places to meet with others. So it's interesting to see how those different trends combine. But I think the pub and the club one for Gen Z is quite fascinating. And yeah, the data revealed that it significantly, I guess, varies across different generations and reflective of life stages. But with Gen Z showing this distinct preference for gathering there. And you mentioned as well a really great insight about, I think, even escaping the mum and dad's place, because I hadn't even thought about that. But you're right, in terms of, we know people are staying at home longer, they're not flying the nest as soon. So it makes sense that if you're living with mum and dad, you're not maybe inviting as many people over because it's a shared space. It's not just your apartment that you've got to go find other places to live. So I think it is reflective of that life stage as well.
Yeah, and I might be sharing my own story a bit too much there, but I think that's right. I certainly enjoyed getting out of mum and dad's space, and I think that's just a part of shifting life stages as we think through the different ages and stages with different generations having different financial capability, different social aspirations as well. I think in my late 30s now as a Gen Y, I'm happy if I see one mate once a month. I've done well if I get that, whereas I think back in my early 20s, I'd have been very disappointed in seeing one friend once a month. It was certainly every other day I'd want to catch up with someone and hang out. Now I'm a bit more extroverted probably back then than I am now, but I think our personality, but also those financial and social conditions shape where we can hang out with people, and even the built sort of architecture that we live in. If we're shifting towards a smaller dwelling and a more vertical community as we live in more apartments in Sydney, for example, we've got 3 out of 10 dwellings are apartments. So I think that built form actually affects where we go and find connection. So we might be having fewer of those interactions in the home. We might be looking for more out in places like parks. And I think that green space is key as we look to the future as well. So yeah, that's really, I think a key part is the different life stages, and that's why I love talking about generations when we're on the podcast, and what a privilege to cut the data by that.
Yeah, it's so good. And you're right, I think the built environment is another trend. It's almost like we can put different lenses over the data and I guess look at causes and why different generations have that, whether it's life stage, personality, where they live, what's available to them. There's so many ways to cut it. And even particularly, again, just by generation, we looked at some of the differences there. And it was also interesting to see, pubs and clubs for the younger generations, but also the local shopping center was quite important for older generations, which I think, again, makes sense in terms of where they go. They're not maybe going to the workplace to look for community. They're going to the shops to meet with people, to have coffee, that more social experience, which, again, is sometimes reminiscent of lockdown. You remember those days where you're like, oh, I'm going to the shop. Like, I'm going on an outing to buy my groceries. So it's interesting.
But you couldn't even sit down and have a real coffee. You'd have to get takeaway. And it was such an interesting time. And Yeah, it's great to be on the podcast to reflect on how lockdowns have changed our society and our psychology as individuals and communities. We've moved on, and I think in a good way, tried to leave lockdowns in the past, but there's still a lot, I think, to reflect on and to absorb into our future. We did reevaluate life and our values, our priorities, and we've certainly designed lifestyles, I think, at the moment, probably that we were sitting in lockdowns going, when I get out, this is what I want to do. And while finances might be going up or down in people's conditions at the moment, it certainly can be good to have those directions of how do we want to live? What types of communities do we want to participate in? It might be the health-based communities, the faith-based communities, the kind of tech-focused esports, but you still meet up to do gaming online, or there's so many different types of community today. And I think we've all been a bit more aspirational and focused in being selective about which communities we'll be involved with as we sort of emerge from lockdowns. And isn't there a little sub kind of community for everything these days? It's so fascinating seeing all the different types of groups that are out there now, and you see them on Facebook or different places like Reddit, where you see all the little subgroups come up and you think, wow, couldn't believe there's a group for that. So yeah, it's a lot of fun.
It is great. There's so many ways, which is cool, I guess, even through using Facebook and social media to find people who have maybe niche interests or hobbies. So it's cool to see that that's facilitating community in different ways today. I think it was something else that stood out to me from this study was the value of the workplace. And I mean, this is something that we've done a lot of research on. It was kind of the premise of work well-being, this whole book that we endeavored and researched filled that book. But it's also, I guess, intriguing just to see the shift over time, even of the role of the workplace and how that's transformed into more than just a professional setting, but it's also now a real space for many people where they're able to forge those meaningful social connections, particularly and interestingly among younger generations who are looking for more than just remuneration from their jobs. They're looking for social connection and friendships, which is an interesting tension, I think, for organizations to manage and to lead, to say that the workplace needs boundaries and these are your friends, but they're also your colleagues. So there's a few blurring lines there, but Geoff, I'd be keen to hear your thoughts on this particular finding and what you feel like maybe some of the driving forces behind this phenomenon, and also how it can impact, again, the future of workplaces and even, you know, how they're designed, and I guess remote work can come into that. So there's a lot of things that go on with regards to this particular finding.
Yeah, it's fascinating to see the younger generation most expecting to have that social community in the workplace. They're higher in that desire than the Gen Ys and Gen Xs. So what it kind of really stands out to me is that you might go to a job for an economic purpose as your primary motivator, but there are these secondary motivators. And I think we're looking at an era where it's been an employee's market in terms of we've got incredibly low unemployment. So employers are searching for the right talent. It's a chance for employees to really pick the place that suits them. We had a word of the year going back, I think, in 2019 or 2018 that was toxic. And so toxic workplace cultures were a big issue in that era. And so employees now have said, well, I'll move with my feet to a better culture, a better community. And that power of a team, I think, is so key. And we're certainly shifting from those hierarchical org structures to a bit more of a flat team-based approach. And you still have a manager, but we want to get on well with our manager and have real life conversations and share the journey of the ups and downs of work and life in our team settings. And I think that's the shift. It's a little bit more... you use the word blurred, and I think that's an okay thing. We don't have to be too compartmentalized. And as a guy, I'm very aware I've got my own little boxes of compartments that I think in and do life in. But it's good to blur those and build those kind of overlapping circles. I think that's when we get the best out of life, when we share life with people around us. And building community in the workplace is a brilliant thing for productivity. When you've got high trust, you're going to get a greater outcome in terms of productivity. When you've got good communication and you understand each other in your team or your colleagues, you're certainly going to have more productivity again, and those benefits as you do that job with people who you're getting on well with, you're communicating well and you're trusting them. I think those three would be a greater recipe for a success. So I think and I know it's in Work Wellbeing, Ash, you wrote the book, but it's that culture purpose and impacts. The engagement equation is key, and that C of culture is a key thing I think young people are looking for in the workplace. It's not just a rung on a ladder that they're trying to take a step. They're trying to build a community in the workplace and want to form great friendships. And so being able to foster that as a manager or a leader, whether you're a principal or a CEO, you sort of really need to take that into consideration that, yeah, building those social kind of connections is key. And that comes down to things like designing the office of the future. You need to plan for social space, and even out into society as well. We need to build cities and communities that have space for people to connect and share life with I think a real safety and environmental consciousness to it, as well as that sort of, I guess, economic condition as well, where it shouldn't be only the most well-off that can access community in sort of elite clubs or paid access only. We need to create these accessible communities and the social infrastructure to do that for everyone.
Yeah, it's really great insight, Geoff. And I think, yeah, it's some interesting stats for people who, particularly, I guess, like you said, leaders and managers who are trying to maybe incentivize or encourage people back into the workplace to consider the value of the physical space and that brings to people, particularly with regards to their social connection and community, because that's really important, especially for younger generations. But it's so hard to do. And I think all of us felt that lack of it when we were all working remotely and you weren't connecting and you didn't get those incidental moments of laughter or connection or fun, or even collaborating on work tasks. It's just so different when you're fully remote. So as organizations seek to, I guess, bring people back or encourage them to come back if they've been fully remote, even after lockdowns, it's a fascinating kind of thing to pitch to employees who maybe have gotten used to that. And I think even one thing I've been reflecting on even is just some of the things that you don't realize that you're learning when you're in the actual same work space as people, and the value of place, and even hearing how people interact on the phone or how people work with clients. Like if you're especially a young new employee or someone new to the workforce, you actually may be missing out on quite a lot by being more remote. So it's interesting to see as we now readjust to back to normal, so to speak, or the new normal, what we want to take with us into the future and what's timeless. But all of this is fascinating as well, just to consider from the employee perspective. Like you said, it is an employee's market. So it's been fascinating to investigate this. And I guess for us, you know, we looked at, it's amazing that all these insights have come out of two questions in this study around where I guess people find regular social interaction and community and where they experience meaningful connections. And the concept of meaningful social connections does transcend physical spaces, but physical spaces do play a role in that. So we were investigating all of these things. Geoff, I wonder if you could dive deeper into the findings regarding where Australians feel the most meaningful and regular social connections and how these patterns might influence the design of communities in the future.
Yeah, it's fascinating, isn't it, what came out of just a couple of questions. So the place people find the most fulfilling experience of community is actually their household, followed by the local neighbourhood and then the workplace. And so even the home itself, that place of rest, of where we sleep, where we eat, where we just share life. One in five Australian homes is a single person home. So just recognising that not everybody has a community in their home, but for the vast majority of Australians, the home is a place of connection with a few people. And so I guess we really can see that that's a fulfilling experience for a lot of Australians. So it's certainly fascinating that it's the home, then the neighbourhood, which is that sort of next concentric circle out of people just connecting with those near to them. And isn't it brilliant? I was just up at the local public school today where my daughter goes, and had the neighbour's kid come up and say good day when he saw me in the playground as I was up there to support my daughter doing a little thing in the assembly today. And yeah, just those little connections that you build, and little friendships, little interactions with neighbours and people in our close kind of proximity. That's certainly a fulfilling experience. And those everyday interactions matter. And I think Australians are brilliant at doing that. And the really, I think, exemplary quality of Australians is that we kind of dig in when things are tough. And it might take a crisis sometimes to form community, but certainly everyday life can be an opportunity to build community. I think it's just amplified when we go through a crisis, and haven't we had a few of those here on our own shores in Australia over the last 3 or 4 years? So I think Australians during crisis are brilliant at building community. We go beyond just looking out for ourselves. We look out for our neighbours. We look out for those nearby. And to see the workplace in third place is quite remarkable. It's not just the place where you go and you put up with your boss and you hide away from your teammates. People are building meaningful, fulfilling connections while they're getting their job done. It's a really remarkable thing. And it's, I think you know the stat, Ash, we spent a third of our lives in the workplace is, I think what you've said in the book, correct me if I've got that wrong, but I think there's a huge work, and it's not like a work-life balance. I like to try and think of it like a work-life progress. Our life is progressing while we're at work. We don't have to do everything in equal portions. We don't sleep as much as we kind of socialize with our friends. It would be, or eat as much as we sleep. It would be wild if we tried to balance 8 hours of eating with 8 hours of sleeping. It's just about progressing things in the right balance. And if we get the ingredients right for life, I think we have great success. And it's great to see Australians having fulfilling experiences of community in the homes, with their neighbors in that community, and in the workplace. It's brilliant to see in the data.
Yeah, it's really encouraging. And like you said, it is quite remarkable that the workplace does feature there. It's amazing. And it's an incredible opportunity for workplaces, not to put more pressure on, but just to, like, that might be someone, if it's like you said, if they are living in a single person household or they don't have a lot of other community connections, that might be where they do get their regular, meaningful social interaction. And so it's playing a lot more, like, work is today playing a much bigger role in someone's life than just where they come to get remunerated. So it's incredible. And I read another article recently as well, just even around the loneliness epidemic and how, yeah, many people don't have a lot of close connections or community around them. And so we know that, yeah, community is a bit of an antidote to loneliness, and however people can find that, it's incredibly important to their overall well-being, mental, physical even as well. So it's incredibly important.
Yeah, I was just going to add in, I think that antidote is, I think if you're a manager listening to this, you're not being selfish by trying to get better outcomes for your team by putting on social events. I think by caring for your people, you'll get better results. And it's not really that you're doing it for the results, but if you genuinely care for your team and the people you're leading, it's really powerful, I think, to add in those small little social connection opportunities. And my one requirement to you would be, don't make it forced, make it optional, because you don't want to have a forced fun outing as a team, then all of a sudden the fun has just left the room. So I think we've got to create optional connections for people. I love that even here at McCrindle, that's one of the things that happens. There's often little chats going on and conversations and options for people to join different little activities here and there. And yeah, there's not a pressure or an expectation, but there's an invitation. And I think we, probably as a society can just continue to embrace the power of an invitation. It says a lot, even if not everyone shows up. Those that are there will have a good time, and those that don't, they still feel included and like they belong. So I think the power of an invitation is certainly something that's it's very cheap to give, but it's certainly very rich in its reward in terms of the longevity that you'll get out of that powerful invitation.
Yeah, that's really quite profound, I think, Geoff. It's something so simple but so important. And I think, like, I reflect on it in my own life and even at work and in other contexts where you never know what someone's going through. You never know. And to be considered and to be invited to things, it can mean a lot to someone. You never know. So keep inviting people is our key takeaway today.
Absolutely. And I've been here, I think, 8 years at McCrindle now. And one of the most interesting studies we did years ago was for Bundy Rum, I think, was the client back then. And it was about men's social connections. And men aren't very good at being organizers of social connections. And one of the bits of data that came out of that was that guys will still really appreciate a last minute invitation, even if they can't go. And if you're the guy listening to this and you're just like, oh, I haven't seen mates in a while, even if you're just like, oh, I'll see if they're free Friday night, send it on Thursday. If they can't come, both of you will feel better because you've made that connection, you've reestablished a bit of communication. So I think guys can probably benefit from being organized, but even if it's last minute, that still builds connection, builds community. You can send the funny meme afterwards or the gifts and have a bit of a laugh in the messages as well. And building community is just something we need to be intentional in life. And that's not just for guys, that's for everybody. That's I think probably my encouragement to people listening today is be the inviter. Don't be sitting around waiting for someone to build you a community, but be a community builder, be a leader, take initiative. And it's as simple as a power of an invitation that will help others feel included, and you'll feel the benefits as you do that. And that can be great in the workplace, but even if it's in the home and building connections with neighbors or friends, just taking that initiative is such a simple and hopefully, as you said, it's a profound thing for people to hear. I don't think it's too profound, but I appreciate your comments, Ash, because yeah, life I think is better together, as I mentioned at the start.
Yeah, no, really great advice, Geoff. Thank you. As we peer into the future, as we look ahead, be keen to hear your thoughts. I know you've actually advised a lot of organizations on these topics through the research projects and proposals and advisory sessions that you deliver. You've actually worked with a lot of town planners and urban planners. So even as we think about some of the implications of this research and these broader societal changes, how do you think, let's say, policymakers or urban planners or communities themselves, how might they adapt and evolve based on the environments they're building, you know, based on some of these research pieces, you know, even from some of the stats we've gathered from this particular study?
Yeah, it's fascinating that we find community in those outdoor places. And while we have great technological advancements and social online communities, those digital communities, I think the power of place is still so key. And yeah, even you mentioned the Women's World Cup, people could just stream it on their phone at home, but people want to get out and watch games at a live venue. It might be the pub or it might be at the sporting venue with hundreds or even thousands of other people. And so I think what we can see is that as we look to the future, as we continue to see the homes we live in having probably a smaller land footprint as the value of land continues to go up in expensive cities, it's certainly a key challenge. And I think the opportunity is for policymakers and town planners is we need to make sure we build into our master planning. We need to build in those green and blue spaces for connection where people can enjoy nature. We need the social infrastructure there so that people can build community. It needs to be really environmentally conscious because we need to create places that will be sustainable over time, both environmentally, financially. We need to build them well now so that they'll last into the future. And communities will change. There'll be community transitions, generational transitions, cultural transitions. And what might be the sports park of previous generations might have been built for some Western-oriented sports, but we might need to adapt and have modular sort of infrastructure that can shift to different cultural sporting appreciations or religious appreciations as well. So I think we need to build our cities and our communities in a way so that they're future-proof for different generations, different cultures, different desires. But we sort of almost need to weave technology into that, because there's no unwinding the technological advancements that we've got. We've got augmented reality, virtual reality at our fingertips now, and I think we need to just factor that in as we plan for the future as well, as we build sort of accessible places and really as we live in kind of more high-density cities. I think the power of the park is going to rise in priority and importance, and it's certainly been my experience that, yeah, you sort of move into an area, but very quickly you could go and find those parks. And I've got three young kids, and that might be my life stage speaking there, but those places where you can relax, where it's free, it's a beautiful environment, I think we just are drawn to those in our life as we find those moments to relax. And we're a hard-working culture here in Australia. We're very aspirational. It's high cost of living. But when we're off the clock and it's time to relax, we want to go and find somewhere beautiful to do that. And so I think the built form is going to play a key part in celebrating natural assets, as well as creating those sort of human-oriented and kind of community-centric design spaces, so that we've got the right amenity for the future, so our communities will continue to thrive.
I think lots of people can see now why you're designing solutions for many of our clients in this area. Yeah. So amazing insights, Geoff. Thank you so much for your pearls of wisdom today and for sharing these insights about evolving communities.
Thanks, Ash.
And if you would like to stay up to date with our latest research, such as this piece and our latest insights, you can subscribe to the podcast. You can always follow us on social media, or you can head to McCrindle.com to find out more. So as always, thank you again for listening, and bye for now.